So, ADVA Optical Networking is a vendor for systems for optical communication. We were founded in 1994, and right from the beginning, our first product was actually what we are already targeting here in Masdar, just a newer generation now. So this was a Metro WDM system for enterprise data center interconnects. And over the time, the company grew. More products were added, for example, Ethernet-based edge network equipment or timing equipment. And today we are here with around 1,800 employees, and we are looking forward to the future because it's, of course, a growing business. Our customers, well, are from everywhere in the industry. So classical service providers like Deutsche Telekom, British Telecom, Orange, people like that. Enterprises which just have maybe two or more sites distributed anywhere, and they need to interconnect them somehow. So this is also that ring. Then there are the internet and cloud service providers. For example, D6 is a big customer, people like that, everyone who basically operates a data center. And then the fourth category, government and education, who also have quite interesting networks, quite diverse, in fact. So that was a very short introduction, so let me jump right into it. The topic data centers, and starting here with an economic slide, what I want to tell here is basically that it is actually a growing market, and it's already pretty big. And that means if you are new to this market, you can even have a profitable business with quite a low market share. So you can see here in, so this is quite a bit old, from 2018 actually, but you see that the overall market size for the equipment of the whole data center already reached 100 billion, quite large, and a non-significant part of that is, of course, our optical communication equipment. So why is this trend happening? Let's look, for example, at the data centers of one company. In this case, it's IBM. What you see, first of all, well, they have data centers all over the world. And what you also see that also these data centers are clustered in certain regions. So why are they distributed everywhere? Well, first of all, data centers need to be close to the customer for timing reasons. There are more and more applications which require strict timing. And this is easier done if the data center is close to the customer. And then data center customers or customers of these services tend to be in cities. In cities themselves, you don't have the space to build giant hyperscale data centers. So the trend here is more and more to smaller distributed data centers. Now, looking at one data center in particular, so this is not IBM, but Microsoft. Here we have a data center in Quincy. You can see aerial view. There's one giant hall. That you can actually fit multiple commercial airplanes in there. It's quite big now. But you already see that right next to us, there's a so-called co-location because despite this data center being relatively young, they already ran out of space, so they needed to expand. So sometime later, this is the same data center and now looks like this. So you see more co-locations. Actually, on the bottom left, what you see is not even a proper building. It's just a container or a bunch of containers where they just placed in service. So they didn't even have time to build proper housing around their infrastructure. So this has, of course, multiple implications for the networking infrastructure. So first of all, on a campus, distances are growing, right? So in data centers themselves, you usually have the highest tier, which is 2 kilometers. But if you talk about on-campus interconnects, then you suddenly grow to 10 kilometers. And there's one more thing which you don't see here, because there was one data center in the beginning, and of course they brought all the infrastructure like water supply, electricity, and so on. The properties next to the data center are already full with data centers. So even if they want to go to another or expand their property, they can't because it's already occupied. So this is a main reason why we have more distributed data centers now. Now looking into the data center itself, there are multiple tiers of networking. So at the bottom tier, of course, you have the servers with the top-of-rack switch. These are connected either with copper or active optical cables. Then you have multiple tiers above that, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. And usually from tier 3, you go outside the data center to either other data centers or wherever. And what you find then is that the networking technology gets more and more complicated. So copper cables are quite standardized, very easy, very cheap. You have them in your home probably as well. But going higher up the tier, you have more complicated optics then. So of course, this also scales in other metrics. So the volume, of course, is higher at the lowest tier and lower at the highest tiers, and quite opposite, the complexity scales towards higher tiers. For example, at the tier 3 or at the inter-data center interconnects, you have coherent optics, which is more complicated than direct detection. But also standardization scales more towards the lower tiers, which means there's more freedom and actually also higher costs at the higher tiers. So the good news is that photonic integrated circuits are already everywhere. But for now, we want to focus on the higher tiers because the lower tiers are more for high-performance computing. So what can we say about photonic integrated circuits here? Of course, there are different flavors. The classical one, or the most common still, I think, would be indium phosphide because it has the ability to generate light. But silicon, of course, is very attractive because it has some advantages. One is, well, you can manufacture it cheap, the infrastructure is there, and packaging is fairly easy compared to indium phosphide. One more big advantage would be hybrid integration, which basically builds on the ability to, infrastructure from the CMOS industry. And this basically enables maybe hybrid integration of other materials to make up of the deficiencies of silicon. Of course, there are other technologies like the passive one, silicon nitride or glass, and there's also polymers. Polymers, there are also different categories. You can use them for all kinds of stuff. And then traditionally lithium niobate for modulations. But right now for this project, we are focusing on silicon. And if we look back at the data center networks, where do we find silicon? Well, first it appeared here where the active optical cables were, which makes sense because it's high volume and low cost. But later they appeared here at the very high end of the network. And this is not due to cost, but rather complexity. So this is good news for the industry, I believe at least, because it means that silicon photonics does not need to be a low-cost product. It can be high end. And what we are seeing now coming to the market is this mid-tier here, where we target 500 to 10 kilometer optics. So what do we expect from PICs of the future? We already can buy those, but what's coming next? And there are different trends, and this is always increased bandwidth. And to that end, we not only have to scale the optics, but more or less everything that's around it. As we see it now, the main limiting factor is actually the electronics, so drivers and TIAs, and how they are connected to the silicon chip. So for that purpose, Moritz already introduced the MASTAR project. We are also taking part in that. What we want to do is basically a fully reflow compatible assembly of basically an optical engine with highest possible RF bandwidth. And to that end, we try, first of all, to rely on BGAs. So we want to reflow the whole package very close to a DSP chip and also stack dies. So we have the silicon photonic chip, and on top of that, we want to mount the drivers, quad drivers and TIAs. This is for a coherent transceiver. And for the optics, we want to make it as cheap as possible because that's the main cost driver in photonic components. Usually people say 80% is packaging. And the only thing that is different here is just the optical alignment. And that we want to simplify as much as possible. And to that end, first of all, want to employ Phi-Context machine. And second, only do a single active optical alignment step. So we have the silicon photonic chip. It's attached to a waft, and the waft is basically a spot size converter, which converts a very small mode diameter from the silicon side to the relatively large mode diameter on the fiber side. On the side, you can see here there are a couple of technologies which need to be developed for that. So first of all, we need through-silicon vias through the silicon chip to mount quad driver and TIA on top. And also everything needs to be solder reflow compatible, which means that the optical assembly needs to withstand temperatures of up to 260 degrees for a short amount of time. Now, if that will be achieved, then, well, very good. We have a very compact optical assembly, which fits in basically everything where it needs to fit to. So for example, there's an OIF implementation agreement called ICTROSA, Integrated Coherent Transmit Receive Optical Subassembly. It's very compact, so it's only 15 by 22.5 millimeter and 3.5 millimeter high. And it basically fits in all the modern pluggables and of course also line cards. So this is a very compact, coherent optical engine, which includes everything that you need, silicon photonics or optics, receiver and transmitter. It includes driver and TIA and also control electronics. So basically it's a fully functioning optical system except DSP, which is so far outside of the package. Yeah, so this is a very good goal. It's very current generation, but you also might ask what's next for PICs. And of course, it all depends on what technology you are used to. But if you go for silicon, then certainly the most thing that, or the worst thing that hurts you is the lack of light generation. And to that end, of course, people are trying to integrate lasers in various forms. Second point is the next step after die attach or die stacking of silicon and BiCMOS electronics would be monolithic integration. So again, to increase RF bandwidth. And then we also want to look into other materials because we know silicon modulators by themselves are also not very efficient. They may be good for this generation, maybe for the next one, but after that, maybe it becomes difficult. So here again, the approach would be to go for hybrid integration. Other materials like lithium niobate or indium phosphide is also faster than silicon for modulation, or even barium titanate, which is similar to lithium niobate, but has a stronger electro-optical coefficient. All right, with that, I'm already at the end. So I hope I've convinced you that, well, data center interconnect is a viable market, even if the market share is low. PICs can be high-end, so you don't have to go for a low-cost version. And still, packaging remains the highest cost, but I hope we can tackle that with the assembly approach from the Mustard project.